Penguin Random House Audio presents Ghost Island by Max Seeck. Translation by Christian London. Read for you by Abby Craden. For Grandma Seneca, 1935 to 2022. Prologue. September 29, 1982. Martin Hedblum folds the newspaper on the desk and yawns. He has browsed through the sports pages twice, but once again, the near Åland has not exactly been a stimulating read. The local paper, launched the previous spring, is more to Martin's taste than its competitor, Tidningen, but it's no New York Times. Martin traces with his fingernail the ring his coffee cup left on the front page, then kicks his feet up onto the desk. He glances at the clock on the wall. In no time at all, the minute hand will nudge ahead to the 12, and it will be 2 o'clock, which means his night shift is only halfway over. He glances at the man reflected in the glass wall of his cubicle, then quickly shifts his gaze back to the newspaper, as if seeing his own image repulsed him. The reflection does not, of course, show the Martin who started as a night watchman at the orphanage nearly 4 decades before. His face has swollen like rising dough, not to mention his waistline. And although the sideburns bleeding into the stubble are still thick and lush, the crown of his head has not sprouted a hair in years. Martin is 55 years old, an unambitious, comfort-seeking bachelor who has lived in the same little corner of Avinamma his whole life, aside from a brief stint when he tested his wings as a professional drummer and played on the cruise boats that sail between Finland and Sweden. But ultimately, he returned to the job that was familiar and, most important, easy and undemanding enough for a lazy bastard like Martin. That was how his professor father, without putting too fine a point on it, had summarized the matter, and in the case of his only son, he was regrettably right. Martin reaches for his gray canteen and takes a swig of vodka cut with orange soda as he eyes the empty corridors. The children are sound asleep in their rooms, and it's unlikely he will be called on to do anything during the night. He rarely is, if ever. As a matter of fact, he could drink himself silly at his desk or, alternatively, sleep through the night and still take home his paycheck with a clear conscience if those assholes from local social services didn't perform their random checks. Martin has been caught dozing twice, and the next time might prove the last. It's a risk simply not worth taking so close to retirement. Martin glances at the desk drawer where a porn magazine lies beneath a stack of folders. Jerking off during the night shift always feels a little suspect, but one of the children got special permission to spend the night at the Nordines tonight, and the other three are asleep in their rooms, so no one can catch him off guard. The intimate moment does not involve hopes of being caught in the act or anything else perverted or questionable, or at least that's what Martin tells himself. He just wants to kill a little time in the company of Desiree West and Laura Sands. Martin undoes his belt and reaches for the drawer handle. The very thought of the centerfold girls has set his blood pumping. He's going to give them a real ride tonight, at least in his imagination. He even has a tissue in his pocket. But just as he takes hold of the magazine, the black telephone on the desk starts to ring. Martin abandons his magazine and quickly lifts the receiver so that none of the children are awoken by the ringing, especially now that he's sitting at the desk with his fly undone.
Smøregard Children's Home,
Martin says in a raspy voice and swallows to clear his throat. The fingers of his free hand urgently buckle up his belt, as if the caller has miraculous powers of perception. But there's no voice on the line, only steady breathing.
Hello, Martin says.
Now he hears a voice that seems to be humming something. It's a melancholy tune that sounds vaguely familiar.
Damn it.
Martin is filled with annoyance. Some prick has decided to make a prank call to the orphanage in the middle of the night. It's none of the children, of course, because there are only 2 functioning phones in the building, the one he's holding in his sweaty hand and the one behind Director Bowman's locked office door. Besides, none of the children have so much as gone to the bathroom since lights out.
Who is this?
Martin asks, on the verge of slamming the receiver down. But the soft melody hummed by the caller gives him pause. He hasn't heard it in decades, yet remembers it vividly. The birds fly back in the spring. The humming abruptly stops. Martin's hand clenches the plastic receiver against his cheek harder and harder. The mouthpiece smells of dried saliva.
Are you ready?
The voice says. It's soft and could belong to a woman or a man, or why not a girl or a boy?
Ready? For what?
Martin growls, but he can hear the fear in his voice.
Who is this?
For a moment, Martin hears nothing but steady breathing. It's 2 o'clock, the whispering voice then says. Martin instinctively glances at the clock on the wall.
What the hell is this?
I'm waiting out here, in my blue coat. Come and get me,
the voice says, then starts humming the same melody again. A few seconds later, the call ends in a mechanical click, and Martin can no longer hear anything but persistent beeps that ring in his ears, even after he has returned the phone to its cradle. He closes the desk drawer. If just a moment ago he was preoccupied with thoughts of a red-headed centerfold with seductive eyes, arched back and perky tits, thoughts of a very different nature have now insinuated their way into his mind. Shivers run down his spine as he allows his gaze to slide past the empty hall and closed doors, behind which the children are sleeping, or at least ought to be.
It's 2 o'clock, in my blue coat.
Martin grits his teeth. It takes all the will he can muster to resist the urge to slam his fist into the desk, kick every door in this dump open, and order the children to line up in the hall. That's what the director would do. One of the children must be behind this, one way or another. A low-down trick? Low-down, but devilishly creepy, he must admit. Whoever the little shit is, Martin is going to show them who's afraid of whom. He lowers his fingers to the phone. A minute passes, but nothing happens. The phone rests on the desk, as mute as if its cord has been pulled out of the wall.
I'm waiting.
Martin mentally replays to himself the words he just heard and finds his arm hairs standing on end. The song the caller hummed has remained smoldering in his consciousness.
There's no way. It's impossible. Someone's just trying to scare me,
Martin thinks.
And they succeeded, goddammit.
Even so, he has to check it out. Go down to the dock and have a look, because otherwise he won't be able to get it out of his head. The possibility that it was. Martin grabs the keys from the desk and stands, steps out of his cubicle. All the doors in the long corridor are closed, including the kitchen door at the far end. The only sound to break the silence is that of his heart hammering in his ears. His footfalls echo hollowly in the empty hallway. Martin glances to the side and steps onto the stairs. The short flight leads to a stout door. Beyond it, a lawn opens up, and farther to the left loom the red boathouses and the T-shaped dock. As he descends the few stairs, it occurs to him that he could have looked in on the children and made sure all three were actually asleep in their beds. It wouldn't be the first time one of his charges climbed out a window and temporarily ran off. But the fugitive would have had to find a phone to pull off that prank, and there aren't many on the island. Maybe one at the Nordine residence 2 kilometers away on the southern shore and...
Is that little shit who's spending the night at the Nordines behind this?
Martin opens the door and steps out. In the September night, the drizzle-dampened lawn glistens, illuminated jointly by the yard lights and by the half-moon shining brightly in the sky. The tarps spread over the rowboats flipped over near the boathouse's flaps in the wind, blocking his view of the dock. Martin wipes his moist nostrils and starts striding purposefully toward the water. And a moment later, a cold chill washes over him. A silhouetted child standing on the dock forms a shadow against the moonlit water.
What the hell?
Martin has the urge. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.